I wanted to talk to our friend who I love the way he breaks it down. He's one of my favorite. Actually, I think he's one of my top two favorite people on TV. Charles Payne, host of Making Money with Charles Payne. You can watch that weekdays 2 to 3 Eastern on Fox Business. He joins us now via the phone. Charles, my friend, happy Friday to you. Explain why this is all just nothing but smoke and mirrors, because what he's claiming here, that's not the reality of the situation.
Oh, my goodness. First of all, thank you for the compliment. I'm blushing. Secondly, I got to tell you, what pisses me off more than just the lies, but listen, he's the president, he's always selling, okay, the media, it was a strong job support. Dana, I want to scream, I want to cry, what the hell? Even I hate to say it, I walk out the office, I see Fox Business, strong job support. Well, why don't we regurgitate this stuff? So let me break down this job support for you, okay?
Yes.
This job support, first of all, we kind of always conflate, when I say we, you know, the sort of Wall Street community.
Right.
Coming in better than expectations with being strong or weak. That's number one. So if the estimate is 100 and it comes in at 105, it's strong. Not really, right? You know, 1/3 of these jobs were government jobs.
Oh.
By the way, where the hell are they getting the money to pay these people?
Depleting the tax base. That's not creating a new job.
Right. 1/3 government jobs. Now, some could be teachers. If it is, then that means that something is wrong, because those teacher jobs, you know, should have been mostly in August or whatever. Mm. But, you know, the bottom line is 1/3 were government jobs. 1/3 were leisure and hospitality. The lowest paying jobs out there. The absolute lowest paying jobs of all the categories of jobs. And 1/3 was healthcare. A lot of that are underpaid, severely underpaid nurses taking care of an aging community, a country, right? Mm. So those three together do not equate to the word strong. You cannot use the word strong there. You cannot use the word strong. You can't. It's a farce.
Yeah.
Here's another part of it. So the last month was revised significantly higher. Like, I forgot the number. It's over 100,000. The revision was phenomenal. I saw someone say between the jobs report and the revisions is over 400,000 jobs. The revision was all government jobs.
Oh.
All government jobs. In fact, if you just look at the private sector, it was revised down 12,000.
Oh, my.
This thing stinks. This thing stinks. And you know what the tell was? The White House put out a communique that President Biden would speak today at 11:30 last night.
Because
he doesn't always speak after these jobs reports. They saw the number. They said, you got to get out there and take advantage of it, yada, yada.
Yeah. We're talking with our friend Charles Payne about these jobs numbers that released. And that's the thing. I mean, you talked about how 1/3 of this is government jobs. They also are not counting, and I don't think that they ever have, the people who just leave the job market, you know, whether their unemployment insurance runs out or whatever, or, you know, whatever reason they have. I mean, that's also
right.
Not included into this. So, I mean, when you take out all those people, sure, I'm sure you can get, you know, a lot, some better numbers.
That's the irony of it. Like, there's six unemployment numbers, by the way. There's a U1, 2, 3. The street, Wall Street and the media uses U3. What you're referring to is the stupidest one.
You know, that's why they use it.
Tell people, I always tell people, just imagine if you're on a deserted island, 10 people survive a shipwreck. You're on a deserted island. You don't know when you're going to be, you know, whenever they're going to find you, right? And so, you know, you say, well, everyone gets a task. And, you know, two of them are, you know, kind of hurt or whatever. They can't do work. So 8 out of 10 are working. So you got 80% working. And then the two who have been hurt or whatever, you know, they heal up, but they say, we just refuse to work. Well, we're not counting you anymore in the workforce. Now we're 100% employed on the island. Right?
Yes.
Even though those two are still exist, they have to eat. Someone's got to feed them. You know, they refuse to work. But according to the rules of this BLS, Bureau of Labor Statistics, now the island has a 100% employment rate. You know, so that's the smoke and mirrors part of it. And there's so many parts of this that are smoke and mirrors. I want to tell you one other thing that really people need to understand. These are surveys, right? So they send these surveys out and to the so-called businesses and households. On the business side, only 43% of the people who got the survey bothered to even fill it out.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. The record was like a 73%, you know, the 70%, 73, 75% used to fill it out. So we're talking about a flawed report to begin with, and it's a thin report. You can't, you know, analytically, you can't make a judgment on just a small sample size. So this thing is so whacked. I mean, it is so messed up. I can't even begin to tell you. But the problem is that the Federal Reserve looks at it, you know, Wall Street looks at it, yada, yada. So it has an impact on policy. I think it has an overarching, too much of an impact on policy because it's extraordinarily flawed.
Yes. Yeah. And that's a great point. Too much of an impact on policy because it's so flawed. We're talking with our friend Charles Payne. So basically, it looks like more people left the labor force than actually entered it. That's ultimately what we got.
You had 90,000 people change in the labor force, right? So up 90,000 is such a weak number. It's such a weak number because the stimmy money is out. If anything, that number should be significantly higher. People need to be out there looking for a job.
Yeah.
You need to be out there looking for a job. I don't know how we pull it off. Honestly, I don't know how this nation keeps pulling it off. I do know there's a gazillion programs out there. I mean, I know people. I have family members who, as adults, have never worked, you know, not many, but, you know, I do know it exists.
Oh, yeah.
That, you know, from somehow they get a check from this organization mm-hmm. and that thing and this thing. And, you know, they go from week to week to month to year to year to decade. And, you know, but that's not who we are as a nation. We don't want to become that nation.
No, we don't. And now we've got all the student loan repayment that has to apparently that's all kicking in. All of this stuff is just it's like a perfect storm of everything bad. And then we got people out there who are not looking for jobs. We're talking with our friend Charles Payne. I wanted to ask you as well. Saw this from Markets Insider. I know you're going to talk about this. Collapse in Treasury bonds now ranks amongst the worst market crashes in history, talking about the losses seen. They're comparing it to when the dot-com bubble burst. Talk to us a little bit about this.
So people buy these government bonds, and they're guaranteed, but you hold them for a long time, right? You may hold them for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. And so, you know, if you hold it to maturity, you get your money back, and you get the yields, right, the coupons. But here's the problem. They go up and down in value. And this is what happened with Silicon Valley Bank. They had all of these bonds, but they weren't worth anything. Like, if you have to sell your bond now, it's worth about 80 cents on a dollar.
Oh.
So when people wanted money from Silicon Valley Bank and they didn't have any money, they just had these bonds, they had to go bankrupt because they couldn't raise the money that they needed. So right now the paper losses on these things, I lost track. It's something absurd. I mean, really, it's a number that – you wouldn't believe me if I told you, like, the banks are sitting on these paper losses. And the problem is people are taking money out of banks, so banks are under pressure. People are saying to banks, hey, if you can't give me a money market or a CD paying 5%, I'll take it out and put it somewhere else. And so smaller banks are really feeling the strain of that. And so, yeah, the loss is really is absurd. But I think what we want to get to is the main reason why these yields keep going up. And this is what I'm kind of sensing is interesting, Dana, because now I'm hearing more and more Wall Street economists talk about this. But, and by the way, that I know who are left-leaning.
Oh, interesting.
Now they're saying fiscal spending is out of control. And here's your problem. Because your biggest buyers for our bonds, historically, in the last 20 years, in the last 10 years, China was number one, mm-hmm. but they've been selling like crazy. Japan has moved into number one. But Japan, they have their own bonds, and they're letting those yields go up. So now if you're Japanese, instead of buying U.S., you may just say, let me stay at home. The Federal Reserve is the number one buyer, but they're not buying anymore. Saudi Arabia has been selling like crazy. So all your major buyers, and even banks, all your major buyers of bonds are not around, but the government needs to raise money. We've $2 trillion since the debt ceiling removed. I mean, this is nuts, right? The amount of money the government is raising right now is like $200 billion almost a day. The numbers are just hard for me to acknowledge or even try to share with people. But so here's the thing. It's for me to get you to buy these bonds, I have to make the yield has to go up to make them attractive. And we know economics 101, supply and demand. If there's too much supply, the price, right, will have to be adjusted.
Right.
So the bonds are going to go down, and the yields are going to go up, and it hurts everybody. Oh. And you know who it hurts more than anybody else with these interest rates and these yields? It's poor people.
Yep.
You know, I mean, we have the highest credit card interest payments in history. But if you're a rich person and you actually invest in bonds, you're doing pretty good. So rich people are doing okay, poor people aren't, and somehow the Federal Reserve thinks it's going to break the back of the economy by this strategy. Unfortunately, they don't have a choice if Joe Biden keeps spending money, which he won't. By the way, Joe Biden and the Republicans.
Yeah, right? True. True. Like, that's right.
You know.
That is right.
You removed the debt ceiling, and it's been a free-for-all. Since they removed the debt ceiling, it's been a free-for-all. A free-for-all. A crazy free-for-all.
Yeah. If only someone whose name rhymed with Schmarls Maine warned everyone that, you know, this was going to happen, you know, like back before it all went down. Good heavens. Charles Payne, yeah. Making Money with Charles Payne. You can watch him on Fox Business, and make sure you do. One of my favorite people, 2 to 3 Eastern. We so appreciate you breaking this down for us, my friend.
I love coming on with you. Thank you.
Of course. Take care. Have a great weekend.